So it's an honor to have you with us.
Oh, great. Thank you. My pleasure.
And okay, so I'll leave you with the attendees.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Okay, so thank you everybody for taking the time out of your busy days to attend this talk. I think I know that you'll learn a lot of good stuff. So anyways, my topic today is just do an overview of Disciplined Agile Delivery, and I will walk you through some of the fundamentals of what DAD is all about, as well as I'll make the argument that DAD is really the foundation from which to scale Agile. The basic idea is that you basically need to have a solid foundation before you can actually take on some of these harder problems that we hear about out there. So anyways, let's get into it. So first of all, I hope that I will get you thinking outside of the box. So if you're new to Agile, then I will definitely get you thinking outside of the box. If you are very familiar with Agile, chances are pretty good you've been doing Scrum or Kanban or some other good thing, which is wonderful. I'm also hopefully going to get those people to think outside of the box too, because I'm a firm believer in taking a look at the big picture and asking basic questions, as in, you know, how does this work from end to end? How does this Agile stuff fit into the overall IT department, as opposed to just focusing on individual teams? So when you take a look at the bigger picture, when you start asking questions around you know, how does all this stuff fit together, you end up with a slightly different view of the universe than say what we're hearing about from the Scrum guys. But which is great, you know, don't get me wrong, Scrum is there's some great ideas there, but you know, they take on, you know, the scope that they take on. So what I'm gonna try to do is answer three basic questions. First of all, what is this Disciplined Agile Delivery thing all about? Just to give you a very brief introduction. Then I'm going to talk a fair bit actually, about what it actually means to scale Agile. A lot of people think that it means doing large teams or programs, which is one vision, and, you know, fair enough, but it's certainly not the whole vision. So once again, we need to look at the big picture and deal with the issues that enterprises are actually dealing with in reality. And finally, I'm gonna, you know, show you some industry data that explores whether or not people are actually scaling Agile. So I'm gonna try to convince you that I'm not telling you a story, that, you know, everything I just told you about is actually real and people are actually doing it. So anyways, what does this look like? So Disciplined Agile Delivery is what we call a process decision framework. It's not really a methodology. And what we mean by that is it's based on this observation that teams and organizations are making important process decisions all the time. You might not know, you might not recognize that you're doing it, but you are in fact doing it. And I'll walk you through some diagrams that will hopefully make it a little clearer what's actually going on. And the other observation we've made is that generally people are not process experts. They process is not their passion. It's not something they're an expert in. And yet they're expected to make these decisions and, you know, make organizational structure decisions as well. And as a result, what I see over and over and over again is Agile teams making local optimization and, maybe doing what's best for them or what they believe to be best for them to the best of their knowledge, you know, which is fair enough. But it's often not as effective as it could be, simply because they didn't know they had options. They didn't know they didn't even realize they were making important process decisions. They were just doing what they, you know, read about or seen their colleagues do. So the goal of Disciplined Agile Delivery is to help make these decisions explicit and to help surface them and to help you understand you've got options, and that you're making important, and you're making, there's trade-offs. So choose the options that are best for you, which might not be, you know, what you've been certified in, or, you know, might not be exactly what, you know, the official methodology is from other people, but it's certainly what's best for you. So, you know, let's try to figure out, let's actually own our process. Let's actually do things that make sense for the situation that we find ourselves in. And this is what Disciplined Agile Delivery is all about. So there's some basic characteristics of DAD that I think you'll at least anybody experienced that with Agile will soon recognize. You know, it's very people oriented. People build solutions. So, you know, we need to make sure that we're working together effectively. It's learning oriented, so we bring a lot of lean ideas into DAD. It's solution focused, not just software focused. I think one of the challenges in the Agile community right now is that it's overly focused on software. And you know, we're not just doing software. You know, we're building real solutions. You know, the software runs on hardware. We have supporting documentation. We often change the business process around the usage of this solution. We often change the organization structure around the usage of this solution. So we really need to look at the big picture, not just the cool software stuff. You know, if we're to actually, you know, help support our end users, our customers, our stakeholders appropriately. It's enterprise aware. I'll talk about that in a bit. So we look at the bigger picture, not just the team picture. It's a hybrid and it's goal driven, which we'll see is probably the secret sauce for us for scaling, because these overly prescriptive approaches that are you know fairly popular right now, they work in some situations, but they're a bit of a disaster in other situations. And you need to be able to tailor your approach to meet the needs of the situation you find yourself in. And this goal-driven approach is what makes it, as easy as possible. So anyways, as I said, the Disciplined Agile Delivery framework is a hybrid. We take ideas from all over the place. So Disciplined Agile Delivery actually is empirical. It came from observations of the team that I was working with and some of our business partners when I was at IBM. So I spent 6 years at IBM helping customer organizations understand what this Agile stuff is, what this Lean stuff is, and helping them apply it at scale. So as a result, I got to go around the world and to see and work with these companies that were doing Agile, sometimes well, sometimes not so well, almost always at scale, almost always in enterprise class situations. So I got to see some of the harder environments in which to do Agile, and others as well that I was working with. And what we started to notice was that organizations, even though they're often saying they're doing a Scrum, they're often doing just far more than just Scrum, because you know, Scrum is only a small part of the picture. But the what was also happening was everybody was doing it in a different way, which was an interesting thing. So they're all doing Agile, but they're doing their own flavor of Agile because they're all tailoring it to meet their needs, and rightfully so, good for them. But they were spending a lot of time and money figuring all this stuff out, because at the time nobody really put it all together. Nobody really said, here's how all this good Agile stuff is together, really until DAD came along. So you know, there, you know, a lot of the common rhetoric that we hear still today after years are the, you know, people say, well, we just do Scrum and XP together and you'll be fine. Well, no. You know, what about modeling? What about documentation? What about database stuff? What about governance? What about architecture? What about, you know, many other topics? So there's more to it than just Scrum and XP. And certainly, and you know, Scrum and XP are obviously part of the overall solution, or at least practices from Scrum and XP are probably part of the overall solution, but they're not the complete solution. So what we saw was these organizations it was just incredible amounts of waste going on in the industry. Individual organizations figuring all this stuff out on their own. So we decided to document it, put it together in the form of DAD to share it with the rest of the world, to sort of, you know, help organizations up their game. We also saw some very strange trends in the industry. Like if you remember the unified process from years ago, they had this, you know, strategy where here was this big huge thing, and then you would have to tailor it down to meet your needs. And then Scrum came, and that didn't work out so well. Most organizations didn't have the skills to tailor it down, and they would tailor it into a waterfall, or they would tailor it into something really heavy, and you know, stuff happened. Then Scrum came along, and their message was, you know, their message was the other extreme. Their message was, here's this itty bitty little thing, and then because you're process experts, tailor it up to what you need, add in the things that Scrum doesn't have, which is okay, fine. But then what we started observing was that all these organizations were spending this phenomenal amount of time figuring it out on their own, and often struggling to figure it on their own, and it was very suboptimal. And both of those strategies, when you step back and think about it, both of those are very strange strategies. Start with something big and tailor it to the middle, or start with something small and tailor it up to the middle. Well, why wouldn't you just start with something in the middle to begin with? Like really, let's start thinking about this, right? Let's start with something a lot closer to what you need. So this is what DAD is. DAD is this middle ground of here's how it all fits together in an enterprise setting, And, you know, we're trying to take the mystery out of Agile, because frankly, your real job is to develop consumable solutions, you know, these potentially shippable software, whatever rhetoric you want to use. Your job is to provide real value to your stakeholders. It's not to figure out all this process stuff. That's sort of a sideline. It really is not your priority, you know, it should not be your priority. And yet you're still being forced to do it just because of the nature of the methodologies these days. So, you know, let's up our game is what DAD's all about. And part of that is, you know, it's pretty easy to observe that there's great ideas all over the place. There's all these wonderful agile methodologies and lean methodologies out there. So let's start describing how they all fit together. Let's take the mystery out of it. Let's use good ideas from all over the place, even from traditional, even from, you know, the unified process. There were some great ideas in all those methodologies. And I think, you know, to be respectful of, you know, what's gone in the past, I think we need to realize that some very complex mission critical software was developed using these approaches, using these traditional approaches, using the unified process. And frankly, you could not do an electronic financial transaction these days without hitting several systems that were built using a waterfall process. You could not you could not take a trip on an airplane without, you know, actively being affected, you know, your life being affected by systems using, you know, that were developed using those methodologies. So I think we need to respect that and observe that, you know, maybe these old timers, you know, from yesteryear, you know, sort of knew what they were doing. So anyways, you know, I'll throw that thought out there for you. So to continue on, one of the things we also promote in DAD is a full delivery lifecycle. So, you know, let's look at the life cycle from end to end. So it's pretty easy to empirically observe that if you're still following a project mindset, that these projects have some sort of initiation or an inception phase or a startup phase, whatever you want to call that. In Scrum, they'll often call it Sprint Zero. That's a misleading term, because empirically it's pretty easy to observe that the average Agile team spends about a month doing this inception or initiation stuff. The average Agile team has 2 week long sprints or iterations. So it's certainly not a single sprint to do startup. It's on average is two, not one. The average Agile team spends about a month in transition or release or deployment, you know, whatever you want to call that phase, or hardening sprint, you know, through whatever terminology around you want. But also, once again, not on average, not a single sprint. So I'm a firm believer in being truthful, in actually observing what's working, observing what's actually happening, and then communicating that and saying, well, listen, this is what's really happening. So let's just admit it. Roughly 90 some odd percent of all Agile teams do upfront planning, they do upfront modeling, they put the team together. So let's just admit it. Why are we scared to use terms like phase or in serial? Because certainly iterations or sprints occur in a serial manner. You know, sprint one, then sprint two, then sprint three, then sprint four. It's serial. They occur in serial order. So, let's just be honest about that. So anyways, we try to take some of the mystery out of it, try to use, fair terminology. Did I skip a slide? I did not. Okay. So going down to a little more detail, there's a little more to it than just delivery. Looking at it from the point of view of IT, long before a project or a product team is kicked off, we have some initial conceptual work going on, or ideation, initial portfolio management stuff, whatever you want to call that, but somebody had to come up with the idea for this product or for this project. Once we release into production or release into the marketplace, well, then we operate and support that solution. Or somebody does, it might not be you, but somebody within your organization will operate and support it. So let's admit that. What's also interesting, one of the things I do, I didn't mention this, is I run industry level surveys on a regular basis. So I'm a firm believer in having facts and having, you know, data to explore what's actually going on out there. And the average Agile team, you know, roughly 75% of Agile teams are in a position where they are working on the new release of an existing system. So they're working on release 7 of their system, and release 6 is already up and running. And what's almost always going on is they're getting input from production of, you know, new enhancement requests and defect reports and stuff like that. And those are new requirements which should be prioritized and put on their stack and dealt with whenever. So let's just make this clear. Let's make it make it obvious to people that these sorts of things are happening. So this is a higher level, a slightly bigger scope than just delivery. So when we take a look at how this affects the overall life cycles, this is an example of the Scrum-based or the Agile life cycle supported by DAD. DAD supports multiple life cycles because, once again, DAD is empirical. And the DAD framework is based on our observations of what organizations were actually doing as opposed to what the gurus were telling us was going on. So in most organizations that are currently doing Agile, what you'll see is that some teams are doing some sort of Scrum-based thing, you know, following a life cycle like we see here. Others are doing some sort of a Kanban lean type of a thing. You might see others that are doing continuous delivery. You might see others that are doing more of a lean startup type of a life cycle. And yet all these teams are in the same organization. And this is a phenomenally common thing that we have multiple life cycles, that we have multiple paradigms or, you know, methodologies, whatever you want to call that, occurring in the same organization. So let's just admit it. Let's celebrate that. This is a good thing. You know, teams should do, you know, if you own your process, then your team should pick the right life cycle that makes the most sense for you. So in this life cycle, which is an extension to the Scrum life cycle, which is often a starting point for most Agile teams, we just admit that, yeah, here's what's going on. We have an explicit inception or startup phase, whatever you want to call that. We have an explicit transition phase because every so often we do in fact release into production. We explicitly show production because, you know, we should have a target, particularly if your organization is moving towards a DevOps type of a mindset. Well, then ops is half, you know, half of it is dev, half of it is ops. So let's not just focus on dev. Let's also admit the fact that we're doing this operation stuff too. We also see on the left-hand side that we have, you know, inputs coming in like technology roadmaps or business roadmaps because we have enterprise architecture. You know, in these organizations, we have enterprise architecture groups or product management groups, portfolio management groups who are responsible for envisioning which direction, you know, what direction should the business be going in? What direction should the technology that we're going to support in this organization, what direction should we be going in? And these are important aspects that constrain and also enhance our development efforts when we're building a new solution or when we're enhancing an existing solution. So let's make this explicit. Let's start taking the mystery out of how we actually work. Along the bottom, you see some lightweight milestones. Scrum has two built-in milestones. They're constantly asking about the viability, having a go, no-go decision. And they're also working towards a minimally viable product or sufficient functionality. I'm also a firm believer in using clear language that, you know, doesn't surprise anybody, hence this term sufficient functionality, but, you know, use whatever terminology you like. But when you start looking at the overall life cycle, you start realizing that, you know, we've got other milestones we might want to consider, and these can be very, can and should be very lightweight. So we should come to some sort of a stakeholder vision early in the projects, that way we're going in the right direction. Pay down our business risk. We should prove our architecture with working code early in the life cycle, pay down our technical risk. We should deploy when we're ready to deploy, when it's production ready. We should hopefully try to measure whether or not our stakeholders, like our end users, our customers, like what we produced. So this is actually important stuff. So that's one of several life cycles. Another, this is a lean life cycle. We start seeing that lean teams manage the requirements in different ways. So where, you know, I'll just go back a slide here. So we're in this Scrum or Agile based life cycle. We manage our work in a prioritized stack. In Scrum, they call it a backlog. In DAD, we call it a work item list or a work item stack, because it's more than just requirements that we're working on. So let's be honest about that too. So in this sort of a mind, you know, in this sort of an approach, we, you know, pull 2 weeks worth of work or 4 weeks worth of work, however long your iteration or sprints are, and pull them in to our process. In lean, we're pulling in one work item or one new requirement, you know, one chunk of stuff to do at a time. We prioritize on a just-in-time basis, thereby reducing some of the overhead that we see around what Scrum calls backlog grooming. We see that we don't have iterations or sprints anymore, that we have this continuous flow of development. So this is more of a lean or a Kanban type of an approach. I've seen some teams start with the Scrum life cycle and evolve into this sort of a life cycle, because if you follow the advice in the Agile community of holding retrospectives on a regular basis and then acting on whatever comes out of these retrospectives, then you're going to be doing process improvement. And part of process improvement will be improving your life cycle. So a healthy Agile team should expect that their life cycle will evolve over time. You might even see a team moving to more of a continuous delivery life cycle, because if you keep your team together, the phases start to disappear. The inception phase, you know, if I'm working on release 7 of an application or of a system, then there's not much inception work to do anymore. The team is together. I know what the requirements, you know, I know what the scope of it is. It's, you know, whatever I haven't built yet. I know what the architecture is. It's what we've already built. So inception basically disappears. Transition also starts to disappear. So if I keep the team together, if we start automating all our tests, if we start adopting continuous delivery type practices where we can automatically deploy into production, if we write our documentation continuously, then suddenly this transition phase, which on average is 4 weeks right now, on average in the industry, then that phase can shrink down into an activity, which might be several minutes, you know, measured on the order of minutes or hours, as opposed to weeks or months. And this is all through process improvement, through automation, through, you know, better tooling, better ways of working. So this is also something that's very common. A lot of the organizations I'm working with right now, their end goal is to move to a continuous delivery type of mindset. But you don't start with that on day one, right? You'll start with Scrum, you'll start with Kanban, you'll start with something, and then you improve, you get there. You know, you get there over time by improving, you know, by automating, by improving, and all that good sort of stuff. And then finally, we also support a what we call the exploratory life cycle based on the Lean Startup work by Eric Ries. I love the Lean Startup stuff. I just don't like the name because it's applicable to more than just startups. I've seen large banks, manufacturing companies take this exploratory life cycle to basically replace the inception phase. And the basic goal here is you'll apply this life cycle when you don't really know what your stakeholders or your customers want. You've got an idea, you're not quite sure what they want. So you do a little bit of work, you get it out there, and you observe and you measure. And then based on what you learn, you pivot or you cancel the idea, or you think, hey, this is a great idea. So you productize it, so you kick into one of the other life cycles I just showed you. And then you turn into a real product, and then you know, start, you know, finalizing it and getting it out the door. So that's the basic idea there. That also supports a robust set of roles. So because we have this, because we look at the bigger picture, we look at a full life cycle, we look at all aspects of software solution development. So, you know, not only do we look at, management and change management as they do in Scrum, we look at the technical aspects as they do in XP, we bring modeling and documentation in the picture. So we're, you know, thinking about architecture and testing and quality assurance and analysis and design, all these other good things. And what happens is when you look at the full picture, you end up with a more robust set of roles. So, yes, you might have a product owner as they do in Scrum, and a team leader, a Scrum Master as they do in Scrum. We also adopt the idea from Agile Modeling of an architecture owner, somebody who's like an Agile architect or an Agile solution architect who facilitates, leads the team, technical discussions, and coaches them and mentors them. We actively, for many, many years, we actively have this role of stakeholder. Some methodologies talk about a customer, but there's far more to it than just that. I believe now Scrum's actually starting to talk about, you know, using the stakeholder term as well. Good for them. It's nice to see that they've matured a bit. We also see at scale secondary roles coming out. So you might start seeing independent testing going on. This is very common in regulatory situations. It's very common in complex situations or large teams. You might see the role of integrator. Methodologies like SAFe call this out as this, you know, they prescribe the specific role of integrator. In DAD, we're not prescriptive at all. We suggest, well, this role is applicable in these situations. So if you're in that situation, you might want to do this, but we certainly wouldn't prescribe it. Sometimes your teams bring in technical experts. So for example, recently I was working in a development team where we had some database work to do. So they basically had to set up Oracle, in a short story. So yes, we could have figured that out on our own, and you know, I've done that sort of stuff before. Or we just, you know, go down the hall and ask the Oracle, you know, ask one of the Oracle DBAs, hey, can you spend half a day with us and help us set this up? Well, that's a heck of a lot more efficient. So we bring a technical expert in for a little bit of time to help us get some work done. That's a very smart way of working. So very pragmatic. So let's do that. So Dad is also enterprise aware. So what we do is we promote this concept that, it's great that, that teams are building solutions, teams are building software. That's very clearly obvious. But my team is part of a large organization. So, we could have like 20 or 30 development teams in flight right now. My team has to work with the data management team, has to interact with the enterprise architects, has to work with the portfolio management people. We've got to take advantage of all this sort of stuff and hopefully work better, work more effectively as a result. So we build this right into DAD. We also recognize that, sometimes we shouldn't be, coming up with, with any architecture we want. We should, that we should actually be working to a common technology roadmap. We should be working to a common business roadmap, which will constrain us a bit. But it will also enhance things because it does make some, some decisions are already made for us. We need to respect that and we need to move forward. We should also try to reuse things as much as possible. We should try to clean up. So if we find, if we find some technical debt, we find some poor quality software, some poor quality data, we should clean it up. We should fix it. So we should be paying down our technical debt. So we build this right into the DAD framework. Because this is something that good professionals do. It's an investment and you got to think about it, but real professionals have this long-term organizational vision, not just the short-term, let's bang out some code and hope for the best. So it's all about, let's be a little more mature. It's interesting right now, we're seeing a this reactive systems movement. That's basically boils down to, let's be a little bit smarter about how we're building systems. Let's think through some non-functional requirements. Let's build them in, right from the beginning. Let's architect our systems or our solutions. That way they can actually survive bad things happening to them. And that sort of stuff was baked into DAD years ago. So let's be a little bit smarter about the way that we're building solutions because, we're in it for the long term in most cases. Governance is also built into DAD. For many agilists, governance is a swear word. And to be fair, most IT governance efforts are a bit of a disaster. They're based on old school thinking, based on waterfall, based on judging your progress by documentation, all these bad sorts of ideas, which are just inappropriate. They're not that great for traditional, and they're certainly inappropriate for agile. And our point in DAD is, first of all, you are going to be governed. You are being governed, like it or not. In most organizations, somebody's keeping an eye on the money, somebody's keeping an eye on the quality, somebody's asking basic questions like, are we getting value for our investment? Are you building the right thing? So you are being governed. So let's be governed effectively. So instead of fighting the system, instead of having a scrum master to protect you from the rest of the organization and all that nonsense, no, I want to work with the rest of the organization. I want to leverage the organization. I want to make that organization as effective as I possibly can to make my life easier because I want good governance. I want the rest of the organization out there trying to help me be as effective as possible. And if I've got a scrum master that's acting as the deflector shield on the Starship Enterprise, protecting me from the rest of the company, that is not getting the job done. I'm sorry. And I realize that's a touch point, or a sticky point for some people, but that is not that is not the way a professional team works. I'm sorry, that is just crazy talk. But anyways, I would invite you to think about that. What does it mean to scale agile? Earlier I said that there's a little more to it than large teams. What does it actually mean? So this slide summarizes some work that I've led the development of for years. It's actually very similar to some work that Philippe Prouchetin has also been doing. He's got a model that he calls, the octopus. But be that as it may, he's got a great model. And the basic observation here is that every team is in a different situation. So agile is being applied at all levels of scale. So the one scaling factor is obviously team size. We see small agile teams of two. We've also seen agile teams in the hundreds, agile programs. I've personally worked with agile teams of 500 or 600 people, successful agile teams developing mission critical software of 500 or 600 people. I've worked with smaller teams as well. We see geographically distributed agile teams. Ideally, you're co-located. Everybody's in the same room, but almost always. So that's frankly is a bit of a myth in the agile world. The majority of Agile teams are geographically distributed in some way. So if you've got people working in cubes or in different floors in the same building, you're distributed. You're not working side by side. That's not co-located. That's, you know, that's near located, but it's certainly not co-located. So, you know, and the majority, you know, the vast majority of Agile teams are in fact, distributed in some way. And then obviously you've got people working from home, you've got a few dispersed people, you might have people working in different cities in the same country, or even different cities around the planet. And then, you know, you're globally distributed at that point. Sometimes you're organizationally distributed. So on the easy end of the spectrum, everybody works for the same division of a single company. It's a little harder when multiple divisions are involved. Politics starts to get into play. Sometimes you've got contractors or, you know, people from different companies involved. Sometimes you're outsourcing some of the work, so it makes it even harder. Sometimes you've got regulatory compliance. So ideally you've got none, but roughly one third of all Agile teams are in a regulatory compliance situation. Maybe you're dealing with Sarbanes-Oxley or FDA regulations. I've worked with teams developing medical devices in a highly regulated situation using Agile techniques. Obviously, a team building a medical device is going to work differently than a team building a website. So, in a non-regulated environment. So, you know, fair enough. Then we've got a range of domain complexity. Some people are taking on very simple problems, like, you know, building a simple informational website. Other teams are building air traffic control systems doing Agile. So, or, you know, being as Agile as they can be in that situation. So obviously, an air traffic control system is a slightly more complex domain than building a few simple web pages or a wiki or something. And we have teams facing great technical complexity. It's nice to think that we're all building silo applications that are, you know, using brand new technologies completely under our control. But the reality is that most of us are dealing with legacy software. Many of us are dealing with multiple platforms. Many of us are dealing with legacy data. Many of us are having to fix the legacy software, fix the legacy data in multiple sources. So we're often dealing with great technical complexity as a result, and yet we're still being agile. So fair enough. So the point of this slide is that we have these other, we find teams in different situations. So I might be on a team of 10 people who are co-located in a regulatory situation. You might be, you know, just down the hall from me, and you're on a team that's distributed around the world. You're a team of 50 people, and you're in a non-regulatory environment. So obviously my team is going to, even though we can be as agile as we can be, and your team will try to be as agile as we can be, we're in completely very different situations, so we're going to work in different ways. This is why we need multiple life cycles. This is also why we need what we call a goal-driven approach, which is what I'm going to get into next. So different teams are different situations. And, you know, sort of an obvious, obvious thing to say. But what's also interesting is that I work through this chart all the time with senior executives. And invariably, like 99% of the time, the feedback I get from this chart, or, you know, a chart similar to this, is that we are dealing with all of these things in our company. It's true. You know, you look at the entire organization. Yeah, you're dealing with all of it. Any given team, they'll be anywhere on these six scales. They'll be somewhere on each of the six. They might not be completely over to the right on all of them, but or they might be. And, you know, good luck if you are. But they certainly, you know, hopefully things will be a little bit better. Or, you know, you'll be somewhere on all six, and hopefully more toward the left than towards the right. As you can see, all the simple situations are on the left-hand side. So, observing that different teams do work in different ways and give in different situations, this is absolutely brutal if you're trying to put together a framework trying to describe what the heck it is that people are doing in these in enterprise settings doing Agile development. And we certainly didn't want to fall into the trap that Scrum and other methodologies fell into by being overly prescriptive, because that, you know, it's interesting, but it's not really getting the job done in most companies these days. So this was a hard problem to solve. And we talked about this a lot. I'm going to show you the solution, but it took us about 6 months to come to this. And what the basic observation was that even though every team is working in a different way to reflect the situation they find themselves in, they're still fulfilling the same basic process goals or the same basic capabilities. So when we initiate a team, we've got to put the team together. We've got to come to some sort of a vision of what we're going to do. We're probably going to do some initial scoping. We're probably going to do some initial architecting. We're probably going to have to, you know, secure funding in some way because we got to get money to, you know, do the rest of the work. We got to put our work environment together. We got to, you know, if we're smart, we'll start doing some risk mitigation or some, you know, risk identification stuff. So different teams will do these things to a different extent in different ways, but they're all fulfilling the same basic goals. And if we're smart, we'll also align with the enterprise direction. When we're in the middle of construction, we'll do basic things like, well, you know, early in construction, we should probably prove the architecture works. We should probably be improving quality as we go. So we should be, you know, paying down technical debt, I would hope. We should be working on what we call in data potentially consumable solution. This is, we're upping the game from Scrum's producing potentially shippable software. Earlier on, I was telling you about how we're really focused on solutions, not just software. So that's part of the picture. But it's not just about being shippable. It's about being consumable. You know, we've got to produce software that people want to use, that they want to pay for, or solutions that they want to pay for, that they want to continue using. So anybody can ship software. That's, you know, but it's like, you know, if you ship something that nobody wants to pay for, or nobody wants to use, you've failed. That's a failure. Well, we don't like that. This is why, you know, if you remember, one of the milestones was, do we have happy stakeholders, basically? You know, do we have delighted stakeholders? Is what the milestone is. So we want to make sure that we're producing something that's consumable, that people, you know, that's usable, that people want to use, that they want to pay for, so that way we can be successful in the marketplace or successful within our company. We need to figure out how we're going to address changing stakeholder needs in some way. If you remember back to the life cycles, we saw several ways of doing that. We saw the Scrum stack type approach. We saw the lean or Kanban work item pool approach, where you're doing just-in-time prioritization. We might be doing formal change management. We might have no change management at all. So there's different ways that we can address these changing stakeholder needs. So, and then ongoing, throughout the entire project, we've got to be, or product team effort, we should be growing our team members. We should be learning as we go. We should be doing risk mitigation. We should be improving the process as we go. We should be coordinating our activities. There's many different ways of doing that. You know, holding a daily stand-up meeting is one of many. It might not be the best for you, right? But so you should have options. And we'll take a look what that looks like in a minute. So the idea here is that your team will probably address all these sorts of things. And you know, you might not be in a position to, you know, your team might not want to, you know, align with the enterprise direction, or you might not want to do, you might decide not to do risk, any sort of risk mitigation at all. Not a good idea. But anyways, you might make that decision for whatever reason. So, you know, so some of these goals you might be very light on, but I think if you look at this, this is all pretty basic stuff. It's not exactly rocket science, and it's the type of thing that we do on a regular basis. So let's make this explicit. So anyways, what does this look like? So the next few diagrams follow this sort of notation. So we'll see these rounded rectangles, which is the goal. So I'm actually going to back up a second. So there's 22 goals here. You know, form initial team is a goal, deploy the solution is a goal, and so on. So this is what's called a mind map. So as you can see, this is a pretty big mind map to begin with. So let's take it down at a level. So these goal diagrams I'm about to show you are taking it down a level. So we've got this goal, so such as forming the team or exploring the scope. Now each of these goals break down into a series of what we call process factors or process issues. So for example, when I'm forming the initial team, I've got to worry about, well, where am I getting people from? How big is this team going to be? How are we going to structure the team? You know, how are we going to, you know, where are we going to get these team members from? How distributed, if at all, is this team going to be? How are we going to support the team? How available will people be? And so as the team forms itself, perhaps, all these sorts of issues we need to start thinking about and coming up with, you know, we need to address, more than likely. Each of these factors has options. So for example, as you can see, with geographic distribution, maybe we're co-located, maybe we're partially dispersed, so, you know, we're spread out in cubes or, you know, across a building perhaps. Maybe we're fully dispersed, everybody's working from home, or maybe we've got distributed sub-teams. So we've got a team in Mexico City, a team in Toronto, a team in Bangalore, and somehow we're working together, or combinations thereof. We see the arrow on that list indicates that the strategies towards the top of the list are generally more effective than the ones towards the bottom. And the one that's bolded is sort of a default or sort of a starting point. So if you don't want to do a lot of thinking, if you want to just get going, then more than likely, you know, a good starting point is to start with a partially dispersed team. and which is actually the most common way for a team for teams to form. And yes, it'd be nicer if you're co-located, but it's almost always not the starting point, because if you're particularly if you're new to Agile, most organizations don't have this concept yet of, you know, let's put everybody together in the same room and make them more effective. So there's a process improvement there, you know. So start dispersed, working in cubes, and then after a few months, you realize, ooh, all this advice around being co-located really does make a lot of sense. Let's try it and see what happens, and sure enough, it works. So these sorts of things go on. So actually, this is another thing, nice thing about these goal diagrams I'm about to show you, is that when you're in retrospectives, they make wonderful, wonderful sources of information for identifying potential options for you to potentially adopt. Okay, so what does some of these goals diagram look like? So here's the goal diagram for exploring the initial scope. So as you can see, there's five process factors here. How much detail are you going to go into, if at all? What types of views? So you're going to do usage modeling, so maybe do some user stories or some use cases. Are you going to do any sort of domain modeling or data modeling? Are you going to do any sort of user interface modeling? Are you going to address non-functionals? We talk about different ways we can do modeling, so informal or formal. I'm a firm believer in informal, if you are familiar at all with my Agile modeling work. How are you going to manage these work items? So are we going to do like a Scrum product backlog, or are we going to do a little more sophisticated work item list, or even a work item pool? Or are we going to do formal change management? And this is an important decision to make really quickly, because that decision will drive some of particularly your level of detail and your view type decision. Because if we know that we're going to have formal change management, more than likely that almost always goes hand in hand with a detailed requirements document that's very extensive. Almost, not always, but almost always. Whereas more of a work item list or work item pool approach goes with a lighter weight approach, lighter weight strategy towards requirements. So depending on how you're going to work, these factors or these decisions that you need to make affect each other. And then finally, how are you going to address non-functionals? Here's another example, a similar diagram. At the beginning of an effort, you're probably going to have to identify your initial technical strategy, your initial architecture. So once again, level of detail and the types of views you want to consider and how you're going to go about modeling it. What's interesting in this case is we explicitly bring out this idea that there's different strategies that you might want to consider when you're developing these solutions. So you might want to build from scratch. A lot of the Agile literature sort of assumes that, whereas the reality is the vast majority of us are working on extending existing solutions. Sometimes we're doing packages or what's called commercial off-the-shelf systems or SaaS applications. So maybe we're extending Salesforce, or maybe we're adopting SAP and then tailoring it, configuring that. And roughly 10% of all Agile teams are working with package applications these days. And obviously working with a package application is much different than building something from scratch, which in turn is different than if you're extending an existing solution. So our teams are going to work in different ways, and these are all important architecture decisions. So let's take the mystery out of things. Let's make this explicit. Let's give some teams some guidance of this is the sort of thing you need to be thinking about when you go to kick off a project. During the construction phase, one of the things we do is move closer to a deployable release. So this is where we see some of our testing and validation type practices kick in. This is where we see our some of the boring aspects of development. So we see, how are we going to approach our writing deliverable documentation? How are we going to manage our assets? Do we have full configuration management, or are we just dropping code in shared folders and hoping for the best? That sort of thing. So there's a bunch of decisions that we need to make. Things might change as time goes on. We might start with just straightforward version control, but then in the middle of the project, we up our game and go for full configuration management because we start to realize that we're in a more complex situation we found ourselves in. Fair enough. This is one of the continuing goal or the overall or general goals, in this case, coordinating activities. So depending on the situation you're in, so some of these process factors might not count. So for example, when I've got a small team, obviously I've got to coordinate within the team. There's different ways of doing that. If I'm a sub-team of a larger team, part of a team of teams, then how we coordinate within the program is important. But if I'm only a small, if I'm a single small team, then obviously I don't need to worry about coordinating the program because I'm not in a program. So so you can ignore that basically. How do I coordinate with other parts of IT? So how does my Agile team work with an Agile team down the hall? How does my Agile team work with a traditional team down the hall? Because we've got dependencies on each other. How do I work with the data management crowd? How do I work with the enterprise architects? All these sorts of things. So the point is that the way we coordinate both within the team and external to the team will vary depending on the situation we find ourselves in. And as I said about half an hour ago, there's a little more to it than that, a little more to it than holding a 15-minute stand-up meeting every day. That might be part of the picture, but certainly not the whole picture for many teams. So let's just admit that, and let's understand what our options are, as opposed to going through all the hassle of figuring this out. It's amazing, if you spend any time on the discussion forums, it's amazing how many people will tell you, or attend conferences or whatever, how many people will tell you that you can't possibly do Agile in a geographically distributed manner. Well, that's not exactly true. All they're really saying is that the people saying that, what they're really saying is they don't know how to do it. But I'm telling you, well, other people do in fact know how to do it, and they're very successful at it, and they're following a subset of the techniques that I'm showing here in order to help coordinate between these teams and across teams and so on. So I've told you this big story of how, there's large teams and complex teams dealing with technical complexity and teams dealing with organization distribution, all sort of stuff. But is this actually happening? Is this real? Have I told a real story? I think that's a valid question. And the answer is, of course, why would I be telling the story if it wasn't true? So this is some stats from a survey I did about 2 years ago. One of the things I do, I run these industry level surveys, and I share all the data, the source questions, the original questions as they were asked, the source data as I got it, with the exception of identifying information. So sometimes I ask for people's email addresses. I don't share that, so it's a privacy issue. And also my analysis in the form of almost always a PowerPoint slide deck. And so this is one of many surveys I've done. I've done several surveys around scaling. Actually, I did one just recently, which I'm not going to show some data from, but there's slightly more updated data than what I'm about to show you, but it's been consistent for years. So it's not, don't worry, it's 2 years old, no, it's no good. Don't worry about that. Believe me, it's not much has changed. So anyways, are people doing large teams? The answer is yes. So in this survey, so the way you read these charts is that green indicates that the respondent to the survey said, yes, we're doing Agile. And they said, yes, we've succeeded at least once with a team of this size. So a little over 70% of the respondents to this survey who said they were doing Agile also said that their organization has succeeded with teams of 10 or less people. A little less than 60% said that they've failed doing Agile Agile small teams. At least they failed at least once. So the point is that sometimes organizations are succeeding at these various team sizes, sometimes they're failing. So as you can see in this survey, we got some successes between the 1 to 200 person size. There was at least one failure of a 500 person program or more. In previous surveys, we've actually found people reporting successes at more than 500. So it just happened to be in this survey, we didn't get any truly big Agile teams. But as you can see, I think it's fairly impressive that we're seeing successes on fairly large Agile teams here. And if you go poking around on the internet, you can find case studies of these large Agile teams if you choose to look into it. As far as geographic distribution goes, same sort of thing. We're seeing teams failing, both succeeding and failing at all levels. The one thing I should point out is that this survey was focused on asking the question, is this happening? It was not designed at all to look for trends. It was not designed at all to look for any sort of correlation between project success and team size or geographic distribution or other. Other surveys have in fact been designed to do that, like other research has been designed to do that. This one was not. So you don't want to read any sort of correlation type issues into this. But what we're seeing is that Agile teams, it's very common to see co-located Agile teams succeed. We're also seeing that people are succeeding at Agile and failing as well when the teams are globally distributed, they're coming from very distant locations. Similarly, we're seeing both successes and failures at all levels of compliance, sometimes very difficult, like life critical compliancy. We're seeing teams succeeding and failing at various levels of domain complexity, sometimes very high. A scaling survey we did, I think it was about March or April earlier this year, found out that Agile teams are now on average are addressing greater domain complexity than traditional teams. So I would take that to mean that it seems that organizations are learning that Agile is better at addressing domain complexity risk than traditional, and are more likely to do Agile now for the more complex problems, which I think is sort of interesting. So anyways, if you go to the ambisoft.com/surveys page, you'll find that survey result if you want to see that sort of data. As far as technical complexity goes, once again, we're seeing Agile teams both succeeding and failing when they face all forms of technical complexity that we looked into. It shouldn't be a surprise. When it comes to organizational distribution, once again, the same sort of thing. And lo and behold, we're seeing Agile teams succeeding at outsourcing. So don't let anybody tell you any different. So just to wrap up here and hopefully take a couple of questions before we have to end, I just want to point out that particularly with all this data that I just blasted at you a few minutes ago, the main point that I want to make there is that there are teams out there succeeding at all levels of scale doing Agile. That doesn't mean that you will, but it means that it's possible because somebody else is, and so it's possible. So don't let anybody tell you that Agile doesn't scale. Now, how do you address, so why is DAD important to all this? Well, DAD provides this foundation from which to scale. So because what will happen is, as I said earlier, a team of 5 people will work differently than a team of 20 than a team of 50. So I will tailor the DAD process goals that I showed you earlier differently for teams with different sizes. A team that's facing great domain complexity will probably do a lot more requirements-oriented activities than a team that's facing a simple problem. A team that is facing great technical complexity will probably take more sophisticated testing approaches, take more sophisticated architecture and design approaches than a team that is not facing great technical complexity. A team that is geographically distributed will coordinate itself in a different manner than a team that is co-located. They'll use different tools, they'll take different approaches to modeling, they'll take different approaches to development because they're in different situations. So depending on the situation your team finds itself in, I would want to tailor your strategy to reflect that situation. So you'll be in a different situation than the team down the hall, so you'll tailor the strategy, you'll do different tailoring than the team down the hall, and rightfully so. So one process size does not fit all. One tooling size does not fit all. One organization structure size does not fit all. So I would invite you to really sort of think about these prescriptive methods out there that say, this is the one official way of doing it, and if you're not doing it my way, you're doing X but, or you're not doing the official safe way of doing things. Well, yeah, that's nice, but if it doesn't meet your situation, then why would you be worried about that? So let's form process strategies, let's form an approach that reflects the situation we actually find ourselves in. So, and this is what DAD's all about. Let's make these process decisions explicit. Let's make these, let's surface these decisions, surface our options, and help guide teams make the decisions that are best for them, and help them to actually own their process now. And let's not just talk about owning the process, let's actually own our process, which means we need to tailor it, we need to evolve it over time as we learn. So just to wrap up, I think disciplined Agile delivery extends, so Agile requires great discipline to begin with. But disciplined Agile delivery sort of ups our game. Having the discipline to be enterprise aware, it's pretty easy to talk about, but a little more difficult to pull off sometimes. Streamlining inception and transition. We've got to get away from this water scrum fall stuff that we see in many organizations where we do heavy upfront stuff and heavy backend stuff and Agile in the middle. That's a good start, don't get me wrong, but it's certainly not the end goal. So we really need to sort of get better at that. Takes great discipline to be goal-driven, to actually tailor your program, and a great discipline to be governed effectively as well, and to push for good governance. This is often a very interesting cultural battle in many organizations right now. So context counts. So one of the points I want to make, so Agile, you know, the Agile methodologies like Scrum and XP and Agile Modeling and Kanban and many others, they form a great starting point. But you need to bring it up a level. You need to figure out end to end how all the stuff fits together. DAD has done the heavy lifting on that for you, or you can spend a lot of time, a lot of money figuring it out on your own. Actually, I was working with an insurance company about a year ago that literally spent $5 million figuring this out. Like, this is a large insurance company. They spent $5 million figuring this stuff out on their own. And then when they finally decided to start working on governance, they went looking around on the internet and they found DAD. And then they realized, wow, we could have bought a $70 book. Instead, we spent $5 million figuring this stuff out on our own. They'd spent the money already, so what can you do? But sadly, if they'd only went looking around and did a little bit better internet search, maybe they didn't have to spend all that time and money. And then finally, once you get good at delivery end to end in fairly straightforward situations, then you can start going after the harder problems. You can start doing large team or start doing regulatory as you want to do. But if you can't do Agile in a simple situation, then doing it in a more complex situation is probably not not something you should be trying right now. So crawl, then walk, then run. So I think hopefully you've seen how DAD sort of provides a foundation from which to scale Agile, by sort of supporting multiple life cycles, by taking this goal-driven approach, by being enterprise aware, by promoting these more mature software engineering type strategies. And there's nothing new in DAD. All we've done is package and put things together in an intelligent manner that helps to guide you through these decisions. So as far as I sort of assume that people would start asking, so are there any services companies in Mexico supporting DAD right now? I know of two. These are the ones that I know of. There could be many more for all I know, but I don't keep track. So there's at least two. Both of these are based out of Mexico City, although they support the rest of the country, obviously. But I just wanted to share that with anybody who's interested. So feel free to contact them if you're interested in DAD stuff. Let's go to questions, I guess. I've noticed that the chat room's been fairly busy. So what we'll do, obviously we're not going to get to all the questions today. I'll try to address one or two, and then Pedro will hopefully get the questions to me by email, and then I'll do my best to answer them tomorrow, and then we'll get an email sent out, or we'll get the answers to you somehow.
Sure thing, Scott. I'll send them to you. And if not, you can also send a tweet to Scott at Scott W. Ambler, right? But I'll send them to you anyway. We have that question from Arturo Kiwa, that last one showing up there. Apparently, and I saw several questions with the same focus, asking if you have to throw away or how much you have to throw away of your current process in order to move up to DAD.
Yeah. So, the answer is it depends, right? I don't know. So if you're already adopted some Agile stuff, then I think DAD is an extension to that. So all you're doing is making it more robust, really sort of filling in the gaps that you haven't figured out yet. If you're doing PMI stuff, you're probably going to end up getting rid of some of that. DAD makes some of that stuff explicit. So we've adopted ideas from the PMI. Some of the, a few good project management or management oriented activities. And we make those explicit, things like, release planning and updating the plan and, a few other things. The PMI is really sort of struggling right now to understand this Agile stuff, and it is what it is. As far as ITIL goes, we're just about to publish some material on that exactly. So there's some very good ideas in ITIL. Now, how you have implemented them could vary, right? So you can do a very lightweight version of ITIL, which is what I would recommend, or you might have done a very heavy, you know, heavyweight version of ITIL, which I would not recommend in most cases, or somewhere in between. Most organizations tend to do heavyweight or something leaning towards heavyweight. So my advice there would be you need to sort of lighten that up a bit, which can be hard because you'll have to get some coaching, you know, somebody with some ITIL experience and, you know, production type experience, and you know, start coaching them on how to do this stuff in a lightweight manner. But it depends, you know, it's hard to say. I don't know your organization, so, but yeah, most organizations doing ITIL do it heavy. So
another question, actually, I'm going to summarize two questions that were in the chat into one. How do you sell, and who is it easier to sell it to, and how do you sell it to upper management or to the developers? How do you sell them on adopting DAD?
So I'm a firm believer in having to, I do both top down and bottom up. So you've got to win the hearts and minds of the people that are doing the works of the developers. But you've also got to win the hearts and minds of the people managing and governing the work, the senior managers. And if you don't have both of those, then you're going to run into trouble. I think, and this is why a lot of agile transformations have run into trouble, is that, you know, the developers will start doing whatever they want to adopt, and then it doesn't fit in with the rest of the organization. The senior management doesn't know what they're looking at, or senior management will decide, hey, we need to do this. I just read a Business Week article on this, or let's force it on all the developers, and then that doesn't work out so well either. So you need to really you need to sell it to everybody involved, and this is a challenge because obviously you sell it in a different way to developers than you would to senior managers. But it's not just those two groups you got to worry about. You've also got to worry about, how do we sell it to the enterprise architects? How do we sell it to the data management folks? How do we sell it to the operations people? How do we sell it to the portfolio management folks? All of those groups are affected by this. And if you don't address all of those, the concerns of all those groups in an appropriate way, the way I would work with an enterprise architecture group is much different than the way that I would work with a data management group, which is much different than working with the PMO, which is much different than working with the product teams or the Agile teams. If you don't know how to sell it and to motivate all those groups and to do so in an appropriate manner in a time frame that reflects the time frames that they're dealing with, then you're going to run into trouble. And so, for example, the time frame to transition an Agile development team is probably on the order of months. The time frame to transition the PMO or the enterprise architecture team is on the order of years. So you need to be prepared to work in that sort of manner. And that's easier said than done.